Hello everyone, it's Vicky, and I'm super excited to be filming this video today, and that is because, drum roll, or some of you might go, and you can't believe what I did. I don't know how you guys are gonna take this, but I'm really excited because I turned my purple Malden into an aqua one. So I thought I would give you guys an up close look and share with all of you how I turned my Malden into the color that I really wanted. Not that I didn't love the purple Malden, I really enjoy the purple Malden, but I also wanted to kind of experiment and see what happens if I were to change it to a color that I really, really, really love, and I've always wanted an aqua Malden. Now, I painted this in stages, and you will see this moving forward after this intro. I'll show you in the stages that I painted it. It takes about 4 to 5, depending on how heavy-handed you are with the paint, but it takes about 4 to 5 coats of paint, a lot of patience to paint it, and also it doesn't look exactly like the same kind of turquoise, because I think this is the color that I got is the Tiffany box or Tiffany blue box from the Angelus company, the leather paint company, and it's a little bit of a different color, but I really, really like this color. I love how bright it is, and I also tried in the video to not paint the stitching in the front, so I used a smaller brush, but I ended up painting over the stitching anyway, because I noticed that in some lighting you could see the purple kind of coming through on the stitching, because obviously when the manufacturers did the leather, it's all purple, it's a solid purple. So in order to kind of prevent that purple from showing through, I did have to paint over the stitching just because of that, and the actual Malden has white stitching in there. So that is one thing that I will say. In regards to like the floppiness, you'll see it's still relatively floppy. The finish that I put on it is a satin finish, so it's like a semi-gloss that's on there, but you can choose your own finish, whatever you want on there. In regards to the smell, it has not lost its leather smell. It still has a very much a leather smell to it. The paint does not chip off. I've painted my daytimer before with like a Kelly green, and I haven't had any paint chipping issues. I still have paint left over, so I guess if it was an issue, I could always repaint over it. But the technique is very simple, very easy. And once again, if you wanted to bring some different life to planners that you have maybe on your shelf and you want to change the color, I have done it on a faux leather, and now I've done it on the Malden, which is more of a real leather, and it's a very floppy leather. And just to show you, because you know you're gonna have a lot of bends and things like that with the Malden, I haven't had any issues. I've been really, really impressed with how it works. I also will have up close photos on my blog at MissVickyBee.com. It's a new blog, so please go and check it out. And without further ado, I'm gonna turn you around and show you the process, which I'm really excited to share with all of you. Okay, so here we are with about 2 coats of paint on there, so you can still see that the purple is showing through, not a big deal. You know, this might be 3 or 4. You can see on the belt here already though that this was 2 and it covered it really nicely. You'll notice I did leave the stitching, and what I did was I was using a tiny little brush like this to go around the stitching, and I thought I'd show you kind of up close how I did that. So I left this kind of purple area here just to show you up close how I'm able to do that. I'm pretty happy though with how the color is turning out. I don't think it's exactly what Filofax had for their aqua Malden, but it hasn't changed the like feel. It's not stiff or anything like that. Which can be kind of like, you know, concerning whenever you're painting leather, especially with a Malden. You don't want to lose the floppiness of it. But as you can see, it's not cracking or anything like that when I'm flopping it around. And I'm pretty happy. I did like leaving the stitching white as opposed to painting it. The stitching just on the front cover and on the little clasp itself took me about 1.5 hours to do. And that was like not at a super quick pace. So just to give you an idea of how long that took, obviously this part is very quick. I like to make sure though that each of them is pretty dry in between, so that you're not
you know, not really messing with the colors, and it kind of gets absorbed into the leather. But I'm pretty happy with it so far. So let me zoom you in a little bit closer so you can see around here, and I'll show you how exactly I am doing that. Okay, so I have you nice and close in, and I'm going to open the paint. You can use this little nail brush kind of paint brush, but I found that it was easier for me to just use this tiny, tiny little guy right here. So I just dip it into the paint, and what I was doing was just getting as close as I could to the thread and working my way around. And that's really it. Until I was able to, you know, kind of complete it. And I did get really up close. I made sure I had really good lighting. But as you can see, I mean, it covers it pretty quickly. It goes pretty fast, and you can get pretty close to the thread because the thread is raised. So as long as you have one of these like nice smaller flat brushes, you can get really close to the threading, and it'll cover the space really, really nicely and relatively quickly. You also want to keep in mind when you are painting like all the little details, so you want to make sure you're painting all the edges, you know, and kind of trying to get as close as you can to that thread so that purple isn't shining through. If you find that you're really frustrated with it or you just can't do it, I mean, you can always paint the thread. It's not the end of the world. It's a really pretty color. So, you know, don't drive yourself crazy, I guess is what I want to say. But it works, I think, pretty well. You can get pretty close to that thread and it covers it nicely. You may need 1 to 2, depending on how heavy-handed you're going with this. But again, you want to make sure you cover all your edges, and that way it'll be nice and kind of vibrant. You won't see that purple shining through. So that's really all that I did there. I plan on adding maybe like another 1 to 2 coats on this just to make sure that it's, you know, got that really vibrant, nice kind of aqua color on there. But like I said, it hasn't lost and it's not peeling or cracking when I'm bending the leather. I still will put the satin kind of finish on top of it just to really seal everything in. I still have a lot of ink or dye, I should say, left in there. I haven't used a lot of that dye. So just to kind of share that with all of you, if those were some of your concerns, I will bring you back and show you once I think this is pretty complete on how I decided to do, how I am going to go about doing the inside. The inside's still pretty purple. But again, it's gonna be the same idea where I use the small brush to kind of go around the threading. It really doesn't take very long. Just make sure that you are getting kind of your edges here so that we're not leaving, you know, any sign of purple. We wanna make it look like it was originally aqua. So let me get to painting. So here we have about 4 coats on the actual body, and then I have only about 2 coats by the stitching. So I'm gonna have to go by the stitching one more time, I think, just to get a nice covering. And my recommendation, I just got done doing the 4th and it's pretty dry. My recommendation with this though, especially since we went from dark to light, is to allow the color to kind of sit and then to check it out in different lighting. So I'm going to take it outside and take a look and see if any of the purple shows. I'm going to look at it at night under a real bright light and see if any of the purple shows, just because I want this to really and truly look like it's intended to look this color, not that I painted it this color. I'm pretty happy with it though. You can see how the buckle turned out and everything. I think this is a little bit brighter than what the actual like official aqua Malden is, but I'm very, very happy with the way that it turned out though so far. I do need to go around the stitching just a little bit more, I think, to cover up some of that purple hue, because I think it kind of is still standing out. But overall, I'm really, really thrilled. We still have to work on the inside, but I'm really, really happy with this. I think it's such a bright and fun and beautiful color. And, you know, it's just, I just love this color. I'm just really excited about this. But just to kind of show you what it looks like from the purple. So that's after 4 coats. So like I said, I'm going to give it one more look through just to see if I need to add anything, go around the stitching, and then we'll start working on the inside. And then once we're really, 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 really happy,
that's when I'll put the satin kind of coating the finish on top of it. So very, very happy with the way that this paint goes onto the leather because it's not streaky. Even though I put it like in a circular motion, and as it's drying, it looks like it's going to dry in a circular motion, but it actually dries very nice and clean. So you can hopefully see that on the camera. Once again, we haven't lost any of the flexibility. We'll see once we paint the inside if it gets stiffer, but I don't imagine that it does. It still feels very much like a Malden. I haven't lost any of that Malden kind of touch with it. So yeah, that's what it looks like after four coats. Let me do some more around on the stitching and we'll take a look and see what it looks like, and then we'll get started on the inside. Okay, so here we are on the inside of the Filofax. This is about three coats on here. Now on the front, I did not paint the stitching and I still haven't put a top coat on there, but I think I'm actually gonna have to go back in and paint on the stitching. And the reason for that is I feel, even though it's dried and I've gone really close to the stitching, I still feel as though I cannot cover enough of the purple because of the leather being underneath there. So I will have to most likely cover the stitching, which is not the end of the world, but I did cover the stitching on the inside just to show you, and I feel like it covers the purple a little well. It still needs another coat, I would say. I feel like I can still see some purple coming through. You probably can as well through the viewfinder. The biggest problem area, I would say, is right here along this stitching. I'm sorry, the zipper. The zipper is so hard to dye with this dye, and that's because the material around the zipper absorbs the paint, and when it absorbs it, it takes forever for it to actually dye the zipper color. So this is probably like, I don't know, about eight maybe times that I've gone over this, and there's still a lot of purple that's showing. So I'm still gonna have to go through that one more time and cover that. Otherwise, the other portions really cover really very nicely. For myself, I feel like I'm gonna put one more coat on there just to make sure we cover everything. This is still drying after the third coat, but I feel like a fourth coat is really gonna kind of finish it up. But as you can see, hopefully here you can probably see on the back a little bit more. Where I left the stitching, I just feel like too much of the purple is showing on here. And so I'm just gonna paint it so that it's all very uniform, kind of how the inside is here. Even though I know the true kind of aqua Malden does have the white stitching peeking through, this isn't the true aqua Malden. It is something I am painting, so you know, there will be some differences there, but I am very happy with the color. I've always wanted an aqua Malden, and I think that I'm achieving that here. I just wanted to give an update as this was drying on the third coat, and yeah, that's what it looks like. So I will once again come back and show you kind of the finished product before I decide to put on the sealing top coat. Now, the reason why I wait so long to put that sealant on is because, again, like I just made up my mind here where I want to cover the stitching. If I had put the sealant on there, I'm not sure how well the paint leather would work. And so by waiting and kind of looking at it in all different lights and just playing around with it, you are going to most likely be happier with it than if you were just to really rush through this process. I know it's easy to want to rush through it, but again, you want to let all of the colors dry. You want to look at it in all different lights and make sure you're really, really happy with the product before you finish or think you're finished with painting it and putting on the top coat. So this is the third one. Just wanted to give you a sneak peek and show you what it looks like. And I will show you once we get kind of closer to the end where we're gonna put the seal on top. So I've got you nice and close, and wanted to show you the final steps of kind of sealing the color on the Filofax itself. So what I am using is by the Angelus brand. This is the satin finish and it says acrylic leather paint. I go with the satin finish only because I really like how it looks. The inside here, if you can see, it has the satin finish on it. I also used it when I repainted the Malibu from like a blue color to a dark green color. So what it does is it gives it kind of a little bit of a sheen, but not too shiny. If you want something very shiny, you could probably go with a gloss finish, or if you want something a little more matte, you can go with the more matte finish. I kind of went the middle road and decided to go with the satin finish. So it stays relatively true to kind of what the Maldens look like. The Maldens don't have like a real matte finish or a real glossy finish. They kind of almost have that satin finish to them. So The inside here already has the seal on it, and I thought I would do the exterior. So you can see the exterior isn't quite as shiny as the inside. So the inside is already sealed and has a very nice shine to it. I also did the inside kind of flap closure here. So I thought I would finish up with these. Some tips to keep in mind when you are sealing these is to remember to kind of get the edges. Make sure you go and get the edges so that the paint is sealed. Now, I shared that if this were to crack or anything like that, I would most definitely share with all of you if that were to happen. It's not the end of the world if it did, because this is a DIY. I didn't pay someone to do this. I do have the extra paint. I can always paint over it and seal that. I don't foresee it being an issue. I didn't have an issue with my daytimer when I did that. Just in summary, this took about 4 to 5 coats to go from that purple to this Tiffany blue box color. With the daytimer, because I went from a lighter to a darker, I didn't need quite as many coats. I think being that the original leather color is a lot darker and I brought it to a much lighter color, it had to use more coats. I also had to use a fair bit of paint on the zipper portion. The zipper is kind of the hardest because the material tends to really absorb a lot of the paint, and so that was a little bit of an issue. I did seal it with the satin finish as well, just to make sure that none of that kind of chips when the zipper opens and closes. So let's take a quick look here at the cover. Now, I did leave this cover out for quite some time. I also looked at it, made sure that I saw it in different lights, you know, daylight, outside, in the dark, all kinds of different lights, just to make sure that I was comfortable with sealing it. I highly recommend doing that. I know you can get really, really excited and want to start using it, but I wanted to make sure that I was happy with the amount of coats and the color and how it all turned out. So now that I'm happy with that, I'm doing the same technique that I did when I was applying the paint. The only difference is this is a lot more watery and you don't need to quite apply in that like circular motion, and you'll see what I mean in just a minute here. So what I like to do is I just pour it on the sponge, and you can see some of it gets onto the actual leather. So all I do is just kind of brush it on. In person, you can actually see where it is wet, and then I go around the edges like this and make sure I seal everything around the edges. You really want to kind of be not overly generous with it, but enough so that you're covering everything. You do want to make sure everything is nicely sealed, you know, so that you aren't running into somewhere down the road where it would crack. I don't know that this is required. I have never kept in touch, you know, with the company to ask them the question of, is this a requirement or not? I just, whenever I'm painting something or would like something to last, I do like to make sure that there's like a sealant on it at least. Just so, you know, especially with the Filofax, when you use it every day and you're kind of throwing it in and out of your bags, you do want to make sure that you're not going to run into any issues with the paint. Again, I don't know that there is any issues. If there is someone out there who painted and had issues, please share in the comments below. I always like hearing, you know, if people do run into issues. I, like I said, have not had any issues with painting the planners. This is my second one. If this is successful, I definitely plan on doing more. I might even want to do some like designs, you know, like flowers or polka dots or, you know, anything of that nature. In regards to the sealant, I always feel like one coat is plenty, that it goes on this. Unlike with the paint, you do need a bit more. But with this, I just feel like it's so liquidy and it goes on. And you can see it start to kind of bubble if there's too much of it. And so that's why I don't get too crazy. At the same time, I do want to make sure I'm covering enough of the leather so that I don't, you know, miss any spots or anything like that. And again, remember to always get your edges, make sure everything is nicely sealed. I'm sure you could come back if you wanted to and if you thought you missed a spot or anything like that, but I'm trying to avoid that. So again, around the edges, I want to make sure. And then this dries almost immediately, but I do say to probably let it go at least the 24 hours before you start putting papers in there and, you know, letting it, and using it, I would give it about 24 hours, or at least overnight. Give it the overnight. So that's really basically it in regards to how I seal it. I'm gonna set it aside, and then I'd like to show you what I plan on using inside of this planner, what types of inserts. So let me grab those while I set this aside to dry. So in front of me here, I was lucky enough to have the Dodo Pad company reach out to me and ask me if I'd be interested in reviewing their inserts. I had seen the Dodo Pad kind of here and there on the internet. I never really pursued it for no reason. I just never really pursued it, but I have seen it kind of here and there on the internet, a few YouTube videos here and there. And so when the company reached out, I loved the idea as well as the story behind these inserts. You all know that I love learning about a company, and I love companies who have a lot of heart and soul in their products. And so with this company, I'm going to read you a little excerpt from the site, because I wanted to know exactly why they chose the Dodo Bird. If you don't know the history of the Dodo Bird, I highly recommend checking it out. I'll try and link a good article on it down below. But it is an extinct bird. It did exist, and it is an extinct bird. And one of the excerpts on the page that was the creator of the Dodo Pad is Sir John Verney. He is the one who came up with the Dodo Pad and the weekly planner grid, and kind of just the idea behind it. He's the one who came up with it. This is the 51st edition, so it's been around for a very, very long time. It's its 50th anniversary, so it's the Golden Jubilee, and I think that's remarkable that a company has stayed true to themselves and has been in business for that long, for being around for 50 years. I think that's just really very impressive. And so when they ask why, the question is why the Dodo Bird, it basically kind of uses a reference of we've been just as busy throughout this 50 years. We continue to be just as busy, if not more busy, and we're still not extinct. We continue to exist. And so that Dodo Bird is kind of like that reminder of, we're not extinct. We're still very much existent. We just get busier and busier as time goes on. And so I thought that was a really cool kind of reference. There's also a picture of the original Dodo Pad that first came out, which I thought was really awesome. Just to see kind of the comparison. It's not that much different, to be honest with you. I just thought it was really, really unique. And so I have a couple of them to go through and to share with you. And then we'll, of course, do a pen test, just to kind of go and see what it looks like. Once my Filofax is dried and I'm all set up, I will definitely come back and show you what the Dodo Pad looks like and inside and how I plan on using it. So what I have in front of me are a couple of items. I have the Dodo, the academic pad, which starts September of 2016 and goes through August 2017, which is really great. I really love the idea of having an academic calendar, especially since I have a preschooler this year. So I'm definitely kind of following a more academic type of schedule. And I really just enjoy having that now more so than I ever really did. Great for students, that, or even if you're not a student or you don't have kids, it's still great. And this is the 2017 Dodo Pad, so kind of your more traditional January to December type of a pad. So it's already pre-punched. These are the A5 size. I'll come back and open these in just a second. Then you have some kind of filler pages, the grid pages here. These are 25 sheets or 50 pages side, front and back. This is the A6 size, which is absolutely wonderful. I love the A6 size. And then these are more of the personal size. Oh, there's also a pad in here for the A5, which is grid paper. Really very nice. I like that it's grid paper. I'm a big fan of the grid paper, and again, just pre-punched. So I will go through the Dodo pads right here. We'll take a look at them more in depth. First, take a look at the academic pad here, just because we are a little bit closer to the September date rather than the January of 2017, but it's never too soon to start planning, of course, for 2017. This is actually like a nice sturdy piece of cardboard, so in case you were concerned of it, how it would be delivered to you. They are based in England, just to let you know. They do accept PayPal though. I'll have all their information listed on below. This took less than a week to get to me, so it doesn't take very long for it to arrive at your door if you are ordering in the United States. This is a little kind of excerpt of what kind of just the idea. Again, I love when companies do this where they include kind of a story behind it. So it says, you know, the human student can be identified under two strains of classification, both of which rely equally upon the academic pad's unique and entertaining format. The first have minds so complicated that they simply do not have room to store the kind of mindless and mundane information essential for smooth running of their daily lives. Whilst the heads of the second, quieter and more lazy variety are in fact so empty that if you could get close enough to blow in their ears, it would produce the most strange and beautiful sound. Very cute, very quirky, kind of like just a very spunky kind of person, you know. It's cute. It's very adorable. I would definitely add this into my planner because I think it's very adorable to kind of have that in there. The story, it goes with the theme. I love that. Then we have a kind of idea on how you can use your Dodo pad. Love that once again. Love when a company kind of gives you ideas and kind of follows through on their product to give you some sort of like starting point, because it can be slightly intimidating on how to get going if you are not with a system that you absolutely adore. So in this example here, you have your month, your days of the week, and then there's a to-do morning, afternoon, evening, and dates and deadlines. I think that's a really nice and great setup. But again, you can set this up with maybe family members' names. You don't have to break down your day from morning, afternoon to evening. You can break it up, you know, with YouTube or meal planning or blog posts, anything of that nature, social media, workouts, anything of that nature that you can kind of maybe keep track of at the top here and then kind of fill in throughout. I like how they have rubbish day. I'm assuming that's trash day. That's really cute. I like that. A lion. That's awesome. I love that. So just, you know, there's the plenty of like little doodles on here. Just looks very fun. Looks like you're inside of someone's planner right here. On the back, you have a 2016-2017 calendar year. Then we have a nice little front page. Now these are the thinner. These aren't like cardboard. These are a little bit thinner, but still very fun to have inside of your planner. I like having these things inside of my planner because they're great when you're flipping through and just have something to read. If you're waiting for a meeting, you're waiting in a doctor's office, anything of that nature, it's always fun to kind of come back and look through these types of things. So how to get the best from your Dodo pad, and it has doodling on here that's written. Further uses: finished sheets can be torn out and are especially suitable for making paper boats, darts, bookmarkers, or tapers for lighting a barbecue. If folded into eight, and a page comes in handy for fixing up a rickety table or stuffing into a shaky sash window. Very cute. I like the very kind of quirky idea that goes into this, and I just love all the little doodles and just that they're having a lot of fun with this. It isn't very like regimented almost, but yet it is very effective and very organized at the same time. There is, once again, just kind of just some fun how to chain your Dodo to your bicycle or your bag. Fun stuff just to kind of look at and read and keep in your planner. Next, what you have here is a forward planning type of a system. This is one of my favorite layouts. You find this kind of in the Hobonichi. You find this in some of the Moleskins. This is where you find your entire year at a glance. But what's really beautiful here that you don't see in a ton of planners, or at least I haven't seen in a ton, is not only have they written the dates for you, but they put the days of the week as well as highlighting the Mondays of the week. So you kind of have an idea of where your weeks are broken down and how much time you have. They've also written in all of the holidays for you. So you have Mother's Day written in here, Columbus Day, Father's Day, Labor Day. Something beautiful about that is that this actually looks like someone took a pen and wrote in there. It doesn't look like it's printed or someone typed it out on the computer. It actually looks handwritten. I absolutely adore that they did this, this forward planning. It's a beautiful way to really see your year at a glance, and especially for academic folks. You know, we have sports, you have a bunch of kids, you have a lot of things, a lot of things up in the air. This is wonderful just to really give you a good look at anything. If you're looking at vacation time, you know, my sister, her husband is a fireman, so, you know, they need to really plan things out a lot in advance, and she gets his schedule. So I could see, like, for her to be able to put in his schedule and her schedule to know kind of where they could have time off or parties, weddings. If you are planning a wedding, I mean, this is just such an essential part in your planner, and I love that everything is just really nicely laid out here. They even have Canada Day, Independence Day. They have a public holiday for Northern Ireland, Bastille Day. So just really fun to have that in here. I like that a lot. Then we get into a timetable, which is very cool. It says, Lord Dodo is indebted to Miss Josephine J for her design and drawing of this indispensable timetable. So you can download actually extra timetables from your computer, and they give you the website where you can download some more timetables. So the timetable is really great for folks with like a true schedule. So this is really geared a lot towards, you know, the students, but also could be great for moms who are homeschool moms who keep maybe their kids on a schedule. I don't homeschool, so I don't know exactly what goes into that, but just an idea to kind of keep that in mind. This would also be great for folks who are teachers, maybe who have a schedule where you're teaching different subjects perhaps, or if you have something like homeroom at certain times of the day, or you have, you know, English classes certain times of the day. Really nice kind of schedule, but also really a great schedule if you have really little kids. It's nice to keep kids on like a real nice kind of schedule, when lunchtime is, when bedtime is, when you should brush your teeth, when chores should be done, you know, breakfast routine, things of that nature could be really great to put into a timetable as well. That's what came to my mind when I saw this, as I thought, what's a great little schedule to put for my daughter? And that's because she has, you know, Tuesdays and Thursdays, she's going to have preschool, she'll have dance and gymnastics, and it just is a nice way to, for me to visually see a calendar of when I can get my things done, because I can put her little schedule out. So that's what kind of came to my mind. And again, you can download more at their website. Let me get started with the August kind of weekly layout. What I noticed here is that there are different little like kind of fun facts, I guess, that they have written in the week. So for example, August 20th, it says 1920, death of William Booth, founder of the Salvation Army. So just kind of a random fun fact that was kind of tossed in there. Here on the 23rd is 1926, death of Rudolph Valentino. It does give you the week number, so your week number 33 for those folks who really like following the weeks that of the year, which is really nice. And then once again, you kind of have the idea of, you can put your morning, your to-dos, your evenings, however you want to break your week up, your days up. It's really up to you, which is beautiful. So you have some organization, some structure, but you can still really freeform plan for yourself. It gives you a really nice layout so you can see your entire week, which I really, really like. And then, let's see. Then there's a little, like, a little just like little tidbit on there, but what's really nice is you have some space for like note taking. You throw a few post-it notes on here, you know, just to kind of give you a little bit of that free form planning. So you do have some structure, but then again, you have a little bit of that free form on the back, which I love. I really enjoy that kind of format. When I really kind of started using the Hobonichi weeks is really when I noticed, and the same with the Midori. The Midori kind of has that same concept of one side being kind of blank and then the next being more structured. The beauty is, though, that for right-handed folks, you're writing on this side, so the rings are really not in your way all that much. And then on this side is where I would really kind of keep more of my post-its, extra notes, things that I want to like highlight and bring attention to myself, or if you want to doodle, kind of, you know, the whole idea of the doodle pad. I do love the little designs. I love that you can add to the doodles, which is wonderful. You know, they kind of get you started here. and with like the little carousel, and then you have some people in little seats here, and then you have somebody sleeping down here. It says it's Father's Day in Australia on September the 4th with the little clouds. Like, you can always doodle in some more clouds. You can, you know, draw things on. It just gets you kind of going, gets you started. For those folks who don't always want to mess with the washi tape, or you prefer to kind of doodle, that's really wonderful. You can add stamps to this, which would be, I think, really fun to add to the pictures, add some stamps. You know, there's a big coloring book craze. Most people have picked up colored pencils, and you have tons of pens, I'm sure, with tons of different colors. So coloring these things and doodling is really, honestly, wonderful. I really love that. I love that everything is just so fun in this planner, and I really am looking forward to using this for kind of all of my planning needs and keeping it in that A5 file of facts. Here you can see that they're putting in some artwork for you. Again, I probably would be using this a little bit more for putting on my post-it notes and things like that. As a student though, I would definitely would have loved having something like this for extra doodles. There is always something when you're a student that pops up, whether it's a meeting, you know, you have practice after something, you know, anything of that nature. It's always great to kind of have a little less structure. You could do a little bit more brainstorming wherever there's not a ton of structure, but here you have that structure with a lot of great artistry so that you can add your little doodles in there. I just love that a lot, and you can just see how much great, like, just it's just a wonderful little pad. I'm surprised that I don't see this a lot more, because I think there's so much going on here that it's just a great like just diary insert. It really truly is. As I was flipping through these, I really enjoyed them. I thought there was lots to look at. It was very colorful, you know, lots of just fun structure. But like here you can see this is like a bull's head with his feet down here. I mean, you can add so many cool and fun things. You can still add your stickers, you can still add your washi tape. I just love that. The only thing missing for me, and let me just double check, is that I didn't see kind of like the months in between the weeks, which you do have areas where you could do this. And I understand the Dodo pad. This is not a fault that I'm going to say is of the Dodo pad. This is going to be basically a personal type of a thing. So I understand that they don't have the months in between, because you do have your forward planning here. So you technically see everything ahead of time, and you don't necessarily need the repetitive, you know, in between the months where you have a month layout. I do understand that. I totally completely get that. For myself though, I would probably print out something to probably put at the end of my file effects or the beginning of my file effects to have the month layout, just because I'm quirky and I really like writing out a lot in my month formats to really see what is going on for the month, especially now with the academic kind of calendar coming through. It's not a necessity. Again, it's not a flaw that I'm saying is within the diary. I think it's completely makes sense not to have it in here, but for myself personally, I think that would be the one addition here. This is really great to kind of put in your, you know, additional anniversaries, birthdays, anything you want to kind of highlight for the months. I like seeing that in here. You have another forward planning for 2017, 2018 for those folks that are really truly love planning ahead of time. I think that's great. You have an appendix. Once again, the kind of bullet journal thought process where you can perhaps use it more of it as an index rather than appendix. And then you have some, like, just your last card here where you can put some information, you know, emails maybe, or telephone numbers, anything of that nature, and then you're kind of done. So the beauty is that you can put this in a file of facts or any other kind of A5 planner with rings, so you can add things, take things out. But I think it's a really great diary insert. I really love how unique it is, and I honestly am very, very surprised that I don't see more of these diaries online because I think they're really great. Now the pen test is one of my favorite things to do. I really enjoy doing pen tests just because I do really enjoy using fairly wet pens, but I am going to go with an InkJoy pen. I think this is a relatively popular pen. This comes in a lot of different colors. It dries really quickly. I like them a lot. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to write on this side actually because I want to use this. So I'm going to go down here and we're going to write InkJoy. InkJoy pen. And then I'm going to write on the appendix just in case, just to see. I'm just curious if there's any difference in the paper. To me, I feel like this paper is nice, but it's not going to withstand anything super wet. Like, but I could be wrong, but I don't think it's going to withstand anything super wet. These are the Pilot G-Tech C4 pens. These have a very tiny, tiny little nib on them. I love this pen, though. I just think it's a great pen because it's so small. I also love the brown color, like that sepia color. I also have a Papermate Flair. Oops, I forgot to go on the appendix, though, with this. So let's take a look here. So we'll see how that does. Okay, then we have the Flair, which I know this is another very popular pen to use, and I think a lot of folks use this type of a pen. I'm doing it in a hot pink color because I think it's a color that would stand out. Okay, then we're going to use gold Sharpie because I don't know where my black Sharpie is. I'll try and see if I can find it, but I don't unfortunately know what happened to it. I think I was writing something in the garage with it, but let's see how that does. They feel like very lightweight paper. That doesn't mean that it doesn't handle very well, but they feel very kind of lightweightish. And then I have, just for fun, one of these calligraphy pens that's pretty wet. Calligraphy. Okay, then I have a this is an Edison Nouveau pen. This has a broad nib on it. This is from Goulet Pens. This has a fountain pen that has a pretty wet nib, I would say. So I'm just going to write FP for fountain pen on there. Running out of ink, that's why it's kind of skipping a little bit. I'm on the last leg of that, so that gives you an idea in regards to fountain pens. So we got a fountain pen, we've got some Sharpie, Papermate Flares, Pilot G-Tech, InkJoy pen. I think that's a pretty good range of ink pens that people would use in planners, you know, that you wouldn't necessarily use any kind of other wet media, I don't think. But let's take a look on the back here and see how it does. I gotta say, I'm pretty impressed. I hope you can see this. You actually don't have any bleed through, even with the Sharpie marker. I'm gonna get a black Sharpie marker just to test this out. I got a Sharpie because I am very, very impressed because I gotta say that for what I thought this would be like Filofax paper, but it definitely is not. Because with Filofax, even if you wouldn't get any bleeding, you would definitely get some sort of shadowing. And I'm not even really getting any shadowing with these. So let's take a look again. Okay, so the black Sharpie, you can see how it shadows through, almost bleeds through a little. Completely and totally normal. Because Sharpie tends to do that through a lot of paper. But the fountain pen did not go through. The paper mate flare. There's not even any ghosting. So I would say that this is actually really nice quality, and it's very thin. It's very lightweight. So if you are someone who loves to pack your ring binders, you can pack a lot, because if you can see the entire year is this much. You know, if you're used to like the super thick packs, but that's not a lot, and they're very thin, and I'm very, very impressed with how well this handled the relatively wet, even the gold Sharpie, there's very little bleed through, very little ghosting. So the difference between ghosting and bleed through is that with the bleed through, you can actually see how it's coming through in some spots where it's almost wet, or the ghosting, it's not actually coming through the other side, but you do see something on there. I have to say though, that there's really relatively no ghosting with all of these pens. I'm very impressed. I'm giving it some time just to see if anything soaks through, but I am very, very impressed. I had to go get that Sharpie just to really, truly test. Very impressed with paper quality. I will have the stories linked down below to the Dodo Pad website, because I think you should read everything on why they chose the Dodo Bird and about the Dodo Pad and how it's evolved. And I also want you to check out the history of the Dodo Bird, because I think that's really unique. So I have all the information listed down below. Give them a look. A great time to kind of get your diary inserts. If you already have kind of your academic calendar, or you're looking for new ones for January, these are super unique. I haven't seen this very much on the market, to be honest with you, but I love it. I love the quirkiness of it. I love all of the info that they put into it, all the work that's put into it. I just really love it. I think it's a great pad. So thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you again soon. Take care.